Welcome to everyone. I'm Randy May, president of the Free State Foundation, and as many of you know, this is really the first intellectual property-oriented event that we've held here at the Press Club. So there are a lot of new faces here, and that's mostly new faces, and that's terrific. We've probably done 24 communications policy events in this, not only in this room, but at the Press Club over the years. It's nice to do this intellectual property event here. This is actually the First Amendment room, if you didn't notice when you came in. At the Free State Foundation, one of the things that we try and do is promote understanding of the First Amendment and advocate for First Amendment rights. So given my druthers, I often just opt for the First Amendment room, not just because of those windows there or this beautiful column right here in the middle of the room here, which is so nice, but just because it's always comfortable to be here in the First Amendment room. Now, today we're going to discuss another right secured by the Constitution, intellectual property rights, and we're doing so in the context of discussing the new book. I think all of you know this, but the book is The Constitutional Foundations of Intellectual Property, A Natural Rights Perspective, co-authored by Seth Cooper here and myself. So I wrote in all caps here, do a book pitch on sale today and through the flyer, but I do want, if you haven't, if you don't have the book, I think if you're not already enticed, hopefully by the end of the day, end of this meeting, you will be, and we've got the books on sale out there. Or if you prefer, we've got, everyone had at their place a flyer from Carolina Academic Press, the publisher of this book. Carolina Academic Press, by the way, is a very old and respected academic publisher. And at the very bottom, there is a discount code that you can use to purchase the book at a 20% discount, the same discount that we're selling the books here. And also, I want to call your attention to these blurbs on this flyer from some very prominent people, two of whom are sitting right here on our dais today. So before we launch into the substance, and the substance is going to unveil itself this way, I'm going to speak, and Seth and I are going to speak about the book initially. We'll just divide that time. And then we're going to have comments from Rob Atkinson and Ralph Oman, and I've asked them to speak for about six minutes or so, and then we may go back and forth a bit, but we always have time at Free State Foundation events for questions and comments from the audience. That's a tradition we have. We don't want your questions to be too hard, but no, they can be hard. We're going to reserve some time for that. The other thing I mentioned, I think we probably have this on our flyer someplace, but if you'd like to tweet, we have the hashtag IP Foundations. IP Foundations. If you think you can come up with a better hashtag, usually at one of these things, someone tells me it should have been something or another. If you come up with a better one, we'll probably use it at the next event, perhaps. But that's the hashtag. Now, I'm just going to introduce our speakers briefly. You've got, everyone should have this biographical sheet. It's got their full bios. So what I'm going to do is dispense with reading those things. You can do that and just give you a sentence or two about each person, also dispensing with myself for this purpose. So after I speak, we're going to hear from Seth, co-author of the book. And Seth is a senior fellow at the Free State Foundation. And I guess the other thing I'd like to say about Seth is that he was awarded a prestigious fellowship, a Lincoln Fellow at the Claremont Institute. That was during the summer of 2009. And that's relevant. Number one, they're a very small number. I think Seth told me there may be 10 fellows. Is that about right? And it's a competitive application process to be one. But it's relevant because the Claremont Institute, their scholarship focuses on the principles important to the American founding, and with a certain emphasis on a natural rights perspective, and so that was an important grounding for some of the work in this book. Next, Rob Atkinson. Rob is president and founder of the Information Technology and Innovation Foundation. It's got a long bio, but the part I'll call to your attention from Rob's bio, just quoting, says he is an internationally recognized scholar and widely published author whom the New Republic has named one of the, quote, three most important thinkers about innovation. Washington Magazine has called Rob a, quote, tech titan, and Government Technology Magazine has judged Rob to be one of the 25 top, quote, doers, dreamers, and drivers of information technology. So that's very impressive for Rob, and congratulations. Now, the bad news about Rob is, that was the good news. The bad news is he has a PhD from the University of North Carolina. Now, you might think that's okay, but I'm a double dookie, a double graduate of Duke University, and, there's a certain way we feel about those people that went to Carolina, but, no. Hopefully you didn't hear that remark. It was typical of those Carolina people. I'm kidding. We're delighted to have Rob here, of course. And then finally, last but not least, very privileged to have Ralph Oman here as well. Ralph practices and teaches copyright law at the George Washington University Law School as the Provel, how do you pronounce that, Ralph?
Provel,
professorial lecturer in intellectual property and patent law. Importantly, for our purposes here today, Ralph served as Register of the Copyrights of the United States from 1985 to 1993. Now, it's not on his bio. Somehow we left this off. But when I looked at his bio, it was important to me that, and I want to point out to you that Ralph served as a naval flight officer and spent two tours of duty in Vietnam, and he was also a foreign service officer. So in addition to his government service, which is most relevant to us today as head of the Copyright Office, Ralph has had other very important service to his country as well. So with that said, let's delve in to the subject. First, I just want to say a quick word about why we decided to write this book. Both Seth and I support the protection of property rights generally. Indeed, when I founded the Free State Foundation back in 2006, right at the top of the Free State Foundation's homepage, I identified supporting the protection of property rights as one of our chief objectives, in conjunction with our overall mission to promote free market, limited government, and rule of law principles. It should go without saying that in today's digital age, intellectual property contributes mightily and in growing proportions to the health of the nation's economy. Nevertheless, over the past number of years, it became increasingly clear to Seth and me that a large number of people, including those who proclaim themselves supporters of property rights, or even constitutionalists, do not believe that intellectual property is property at all, and that others don't believe that anything that appears online constitutes property that should be safeguarded. And as most of you know, there's certainly a segment of those of the generation younger than myself that feel that way about information online. You've probably all heard the mantra, information wants to be free. Now, whether or not intellectual property rights, and I should say when I speak of intellectual property rights, our book is focused on copyright and patents. Whether or not IP rights should be safeguarded can be discussed and debated in various ways, including a utilitarian approach, that is, do they have the have utility in advancing some societal goal or another, or in pragmatic terms. And these approaches certainly may have merit in addressing certain issues, especially what we may call boundary issues, such as the length of copyright or patent terms, or the scope of the fair use doctrine. Our book is not about dealing with these contemporary boundary issues. Rather, it is about recovering the Constitution's understanding of intellectual property rights as ultimately grounded in the natural rights of authors and inventors. To this end, the book explores the foundational principles of property, including intellectual property, that inform the Constitution, and it explains how these concepts continue to inform the development of IP rights after the Constitutional Convention, through the first Congress, and right up to Reconstruction. So let me set forth at the outset in very clear terms the two related foundational principles at the core of our book. One, that each person has a natural right to enjoy the fruits of his or her own labors, including intellectual labors. And two, that a primary purpose of civil government is to protect this natural right through laws that protect private property. So now, just to elaborate a bit, I want to spend a minute or two discussing the 17th century English philosopher John Locke, who, as most of you know, was a significant influence on the thinking of our founders, especially with respect to their acceptance of natural rights principles that ultimately found their expression not only in the Declaration of Independence, in which they're very clear, but also in the fabric of our Constitution. Now, as Locke explained in a famous passage in his landmark Second Treatise of Government, quote, "Every man has a property in his own person. This nobody has any right to but himself. The labor of his body and the work of his hands, we may say, are properly his. Whatsoever then he removes out of the state that nature hath provided and left it in, he hath mixed his labor with and joined to it something that is his own, and thereby makes it his property." Stated plainly and without that 17th century English way of speaking, Locke understood that each person possesses a natural right to the fruits of his or her own labor, and that the civil society established by government is obligated to protect that as a person's property. Now, in Lockean terms, as we say in the book, the product or expression of a person's creative activity or the resulting mixture of a person's labor with his or her own resources to produce something to which he or she attaches value, for example, a book like this or an invention, is that person's own property by right of original acquisition and first possession. We attempt to show in the book, and I think we do, that the founders in drafting the Constitution, and specifically including the intellectual property clause in the Constitution, accepted the Lockean principle that one person cannot be deprived of his or her natural right to enjoy what he or she has earned by virtue of his or her own labor, and that this natural right necessarily includes the fruit of a person's intellectual labors, such as their writings or inventions. Now, chapter 3 in the book, titled Literary Property, Copyrights, Constitutional History, and Its Meaning for Today, I think is interesting. And one of the reasons that I think most of you will find interesting is that it discusses this, I think, little-known alliance between Noah Webster, on the one hand, called the father of, father of copyright, right?
That's right.
And James Madison, father of our Constitution. One of the things that I think is not known is that when he wasn't working on his dictionary and other writings, Noah Webster spent a lot of time traveling around the then country before the adoption, even before the adoption of the Constitution, trying to petition legislatures, the state legislatures, to adopt their own copyright laws. I want to quote from just one. There are several examples of this in the book, but I want to quote from Noah Webster's petition to Delaware. And again, this preceded the Constitutional Convention, but I think illustrates the emphasis on natural rights. Quote, among all the modes of acquiring property or exclusive ownership, the act or operation of creating or making seems to have the first claim. If anything can justly give a man an exclusive right to the occupancy and enjoyment of a thing, it must be that he made it. The right of a farmer and mechanic to the exclusive enjoyment and right of disposal of what they made or produce is never questioned. What then can make a difference between the product of muscular strength and the product of the intellect? Now, it's relevant to note that, again, that Noah Webster went to the Virginia convention when Madison was there to make this same argument, the same type of argument. Thus, it's our contention that this natural rights perspective regarding the safeguarding of property was embodied in the Constitution in Article 1, Section 8, of the Intellectual Property Clause, which grants Congress the power, this is the first time I'm quoting it, to promote the progress of science and useful arts by securing for a limited time to authors and inventors the exclusive right to their respective writings and discoveries. Here's what we say in the introduction of the book to place our thesis in the broader context of American constitutionalism and the framework of our system of government. Quote, it is our contention that the natural rights perspective on intellectual property offered is consistent with classical liberal concepts concerning the rights of man and responsibilities of government as expounded by thinkers such as John Locke and James Madison. And this perspective is consistent with the ideals expressed in the Declaration of Independence, reflected in common law precedents at the time of American independence, and embodied in pre-constitutional legislative precedents in the newly independent United States. In short, the intellectual and historical backdrop in which the Constitution of 1787 was adopted and ratified regarded copyrights and patent rights as a form of private property that are rooted in the natural rights of authors and conventions to secure the fruits of their labors. So finally, I just want to conclude my remarks before turning it over to Seth to suggest to you that our book is really a mixture. It's not a, you know, it's not a textbook per se, although, you know, we hope it's adopted by professors at, for their courses. And by the way, that's what Carolina Academic Press, that's part of their reason for being. But it's really a book that I think is a mixture of history, constitutional history, philosophy, jurisprudence, and biography, really. And because we try and tell this story to some extent by examining what the historical figures did and what they said. And those figures are, as I mentioned, Locke and Madison and Noah Webster, but Daniel Webster, Joseph Story, Chancellor Kent, and Abraham Lincoln, who I bet many of you don't think of as having necessarily had a lot to say about intellectual property, but he did. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Seth. I just want to say again, I hope we have books for sale. If you're interested, I hope you'll buy a book. I know that Seth and I would be pleased to autograph it for you. We don't get that many opportunities to do that every few months, so we would do that and be pleased to do it. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Seth, and then after Seth speaks, we'll just have Rob and Ralph react.
Thank you, Randy. And thank you, everyone, for attending. I'm thrilled to be here. I'm excited about this book, and I'm excited to have something to say on the topic of intellectual property, because it has the name intellectual on it. It just makes it seem like you're smarter than you really are. Just by default, it kind of has that thing about it. So it's been a lot of fun. It was a labor to write, but it was also fun to write and then put that together with Randy. Our book, The Constitutional Foundations of Intellectual Property, is a distillation of the constitutional logic of copyrights and patents in the American constitutional order. And our book traces the development of that logical concept throughout about the first century of the nation's history. Now, the text of the Intellectual Property Clause, that's Article 1, Section 8, Clause 8 of the Constitution, that's pretty simple. So grasping the intellectual background of the Constitution becomes really important to understanding that text and where it's coming from. Randy certainly spoke to the 17th century kind of backdrop and then into the 18th and early America. And I think the finest statement about property rights in that American context, early American context, comes from James Madison. And in his 1792 National Gazette essay on property, he defines property in its larger and juster meaning to involve everything to which a man may attach a value and have a right which leaves to everyone else the like advantage. And so in that larger concept of property rights, a person, you know, echoing Locke, has a right of property in themselves, in their own self, in their faculties, in their possessions, in their labor for their daily subsistence. And Madison concluded that the most important property that a person possessed was in their own conscience, not something intangible. And as we get into chapter 2 of our book, we also talk about a more narrower definition of property that's closer to what most of us understand today. And we describe how intellectual property was understood to fit in that narrower definition as well. So it suits both the classic definition that is broader and the narrower one that we're more familiar with today. And so what we see is that early on in the nation's history, right before the Constitution, these ideas about intellectual property being a property right rooted in a person's natural right, those were widely understood and applied directly to copyrights and to patents, to creative works, and to inventions. And then in the 1780s, you really start to see as a nation, the first sort of movement gets underway, and that's when the Confederation Congress passed a resolution calling on the states to adopt laws for literary property. And so that's what preceded what Randy just discussed earlier, where several of the states, actually all of them save one, before the Constitution adopted their own state copyright laws. And what's particularly interesting about those state copyright laws is that many of them describe copyright or literary property as a property right rooted in a person's natural right. So you have, for instance, the Connecticut 1783 copyright law declares it is perfectly agreeable to the principles of natural equity and justice that every authority should be secured in receiving the profits that may arise from the sale of his works. Massachusetts copyright law, the same year, describes the legal security of the fruits of authors' study and industry as one of the rights of all men, there being no property more peculiarly a man's own than that which is produced by the labor of his mind. So many of these states were lobbied personally by Webster through letters, petitions. He spoke before many of them. He was combined it as a book tour for his American speller, his blueback speller, which was teaching people how to read. He was an idiosyncratic kind of person, Webster. He tended to drive other people a little crazy. He proposed a phonetic spelling to the American alphabet, which he caught a lot of flack for in the end. Ben Franklin liked it, but it didn't catch on. In any event, throughout all the states, though, Webster consistently made the case for copyright being rooted in an author's inherent right to reap the financial rewards for his work. And Randy spoke earlier about the copyright alliance that he had with Madison. I was going to speak to that, but I guess I don't have the copyright on that either, or Randy and I share it, or did we assign the copyright to Free State Foundation for our book? I don't remember. But in any event, that was great, and that was exciting learning about that when we prepared this book, just that those two had connected. Webster first encountered Madison when Madison was a member of the Confederation Congress at the time, and so Madison was on the committee that helped prepare that resolution that went out to the states, and they crossed paths again in Virginia, where Madison introduced Webster to George Washington as well. And they had some close collaboration in some other matters. By 1787, Madison wrote in his Vices of the Political System of the United States memo that he considered it one of the vices of the existing Confederation was the want of uniform laws concerning literary property. So Madison clearly shared that concern, and once the Constitution was ratified and went into effect, Madison was in a key position to help actualize things. He was considered the floor manager of the House for all intents and purposes. And so it was that first Congress passed the Copyright Act of 1790 and the Patent Act of 1790, both of which were signed by President George Washington. So, you know, I skipped a little part here about the theoretical backdrop being important to the text. You know, the Constitution itself is not an expression of abstract theory. It's the practical implementation and application of that theory. So it makes sense that the IP clause would be very straightforward. But that's in no way to imply a rejection of the underlying theory. The IP clause secures those rights, which were understood from their source to be rooted in a person's labor. And so that's what the first Congress acted on. And in the course of the ensuing decades, you see those foundations being built upon. You see it throughout the antebellum period in particular. Chancellor Kent, James Kent, America's Blackstone, he wrote in his commentaries about the right of acquisition in a person's intellectual labors. And Justice Story, the Supreme Court's greatest scholar, said that that a person's exclusive title in their inventions, in their literary works, was in the noblest sense their own property. He regarded the intellectual property clause as not only a just policy, he just said it was impossible to doubt its justice or its policy. Daniel Webster, the defender of the Constitution, a distant cousin of Noah Webster, incidentally, he had occasion to support intellectual property rights as a member of Congress and his extensive career as an attorney. He once said that intellectual property is much like the original right of acquisition described in classic natural rights terms. And he said, upon acknowledged principles, rights acquired by invention stand on plainer principles of natural law than most other rights of property. And all this leads up into our final chapter where we put the spotlight a little bit on Abraham Lincoln. And he described intellectual property, in particular patents, in terms of free labor ideology that was then prevalent in the 1850s. It was certainly rooted in the natural rights tradition, but it was sort of the expression or concept of how a person can gain greater independence and improvement and do so through their own efforts and enterprise. And that, of course, depends on the principle of a free labor, that a person has a right to keep what they earn, that they have a right to reap what they've sown. And Lincoln expressed that and connected that to patent rights in particular in both his lecture on discoveries and inventions, which he gave a half dozen times in the late 1850s, and he also made that pretty explicit connection in his address to the Wisconsin State Agricultural Society in 1859, right before he was elected president. So we see through all these constitutional thinkers and statesmen a logic of intellectual property that was really identical in all of its essential elements, although differently expressed sometimes, and often eloquently expressed by these people. And so, according to this shared logic, copyrights and patents are rooted in a person's natural rights to the fruits of their labor. And it was in taking that backdrop, that's the light in which we need to read the IP clause, the intellectual property clause of the Constitution. And it should impress upon everyone, especially Congress, but everyone, that intellectual property rights need to be taken seriously. So one of the things our book does is that it pushes back on the sort of lightweight arguments that are just thrown about saying that intellectual property is some sort of government-conferred regulatory privilege or monopoly or something like that. And we see squarely, there are a number of instances, some of these great thinkers that we're discussing push back against that themselves. They identify this specifically, not in the in regulatory context, they put it in the property context. This is something that is earned by an individual. It leaves others open to pursue their own work in those areas. We're not talking about monopoly trade franchises or something like that. We're talking about a person's right in what they've actually created and earned. So we go all these things in the book. It was a pleasure to write. I hope you like it. And as someone who really loves the Constitution and who likes the founding fathers and these figures of history, I think it provides a nice on-ramp to the subject if you're not familiar with intellectual property. You may not have a big background in patents or copyrights or this doctrine or that, the regulation and anything else, and cross-licensing agreements and so forth, but if you have an interest in someone like Washington or Madison or Webster or Lincoln, you know, that's a common frame of reference, and it provides a nice way to get into this subject and understand its importance and place in American constitutional order. So again, I hope you like it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Seth. So now we're going to turn to Rob to speak and give his reactions to the book. I guess Rob was kind enough to write a blurb too, which I appreciate. So, having done that, he can't do a completely can't do a 180 here and say something completely different. Rob.
All right, well, thanks, Randy. I stand by my blurb, even though you've insulted my alma mater. We'll continue.
Basketball season is coming up shortly.
Yeah, exactly. Well, first of all, thank you, and I want to congratulate both you and Seth for an excellent book, and more than that, I think a timely and important book. Should also just add, I actually, believe it or not, I'm on a panel next door, like right there, and I have to leave a couple of minutes early, so I apologize ahead of time. So I think why this is important is this book, frankly, is not going to convince Public Knowledge or EFF or any of these weak copyright groups, weak IP groups. Hopefully they might read it, but I would be skeptical that they would shut down Public Knowledge tomorrow and realize the error of their ways. But that's not really the point of the book. I think the point of the book really is to solidify the understanding of IP and copyright on the right, because that's what's, I think, changed over the last, in a troubling way, over the last 5 or so years. You know, I think for a long, long time, there was a general consensus in Washington around the issue of copyright and IP, and the left and the right both had their differences, but there was a lot of middle ground that they agreed upon. For example, they agreed that IP was needed. They agreed that IP drove innovation. And the differences were largely at the margin. The people who are left of center, as a generalized rule, they didn't really fundamentally care about property rights. Property rights to them were a means, not an end. The reason you cared about IP wasn't to protect natural rights, it was to protect innovation and to drive the creation of content. It was an instrumental value for them. And I think for the right, historically, as you've shown in your book, that the property rights or the natural rights are fundamental. But be that as it may, it really led to no major differences in how we thought about copyright. People came at it from different value sets and came to generally the same conclusion. The left might be, a little bit shorter terms, the right's a little bit longer terms, but you had a consensus that was workable. And unfortunately, what I think we've seen is intellectual property getting caught up in the Washington culture wars. We can't even have a civil conversation anymore about abortion, guns, immigration. There's just so many issues now that are just gigantic, emotional, hot-button issues. And IP now has fallen into that camp, or been pushed into that camp, I would say. And I think that's all to the bad. It leads us down the wrong path. It leads us down a path where we can't compromise, where we can't have rational discussions anymore. And I think for the left, you know, with their views that you don't need IP, that if you're an artist, whatever, just go out on the road and do concerts and sell t-shirts, piracy doesn't hurt creators, it actually helps them, and IP just hurts innovation. As I said, I don't think those folks are going to get religion after reading this book. But the more important one, though, is the split on the right that I've seen in the last 5 years, which is really unique, interesting to me. And I think the split comes about into two camps. I would say there's the camp that is represented by this book, that the priority is about property rights. And that's the core, and everything flows from property rights. And that, again, as I said, it was the historical rationale for conservatives and for most Republicans in the copyright debate, the IP debates. But over the last 5 or so years, you've seen a shift among some conservatives. The famous Derek Khanna blog when he was with the Republican Policy Committee. I assume Derek is a Republican. He was working for the Republicans, so you would assume that means he's a Republican coming up with a different rationale for copyright. And in that blog, if you read it, it was very, very much about copyright is a barrier and an anchor on innovation. And then related to that is this other brand of what I would say sort of radical sort of individualists, I guess, or the people who would put freedom ahead of property. And there's this rise I see in the Republican Party among people who put individual freedom ahead of property rights. And for them, why can't I go and download that book illegally? You're impinging upon my freedom, Randy. I have the freedom to do that. And I have the freedom to take a chapter out of that and just stick it into my book, which, by the way, we just saw a book the other day that took a whole report of ours and put it in there and didn't even have the courtesy to cite us, even though it was copyrighted. So they may be those radical Republicans who wrote that. But my point is more serious one. For example, if you look at Michel Baudrin's book, who I debated him, he's a professor, I think, at Washington University or St. Louis, whatever. And he wrote a book called Against IP. And I debated him against at the Cato Institute. And his argument was that IP limits the ability of people to do what they want to do. And that as an individual, I should have the freedom to create mashups. I should have the freedom to take large chunks of work and do whatever I want with it. He actually went so far in his proposals, which, you know, again, 10 years ago, we would have looked at this and go, this guy's just totally outside the bounds of sort of normal conventional thinking on this. Here's a guy who has gotten a lot of play. He's spoken at Cato in an implied endorsement by Cato of his book. And he essentially wrote that we should have a federal law that requires all blueprints and any mechanical drawings to be published immediately on the open internet. That's pretty radical, you could argue. So I think, in closing, I think the conservatives, the right, essentially has to think in their own mind, really, where do they stand on copyright? Because, as I said, I see this split now in the Republican Party or in the conservative movement. And I think your book is a very, very healthy antidote to that, because it grounds people in what most conservatives are grounded in, which is the Constitution. So I'm, again, I think it's a wonderful job you've done, and I hope at least those folks take a serious look at your book. Thank you.
Thank you, Rob. And we do say, and I appreciate the way you put it, because a couple times in the book, I mean, right up front in the introduction, we say explicitly, we hope to appeal to those who call themselves as sympathizers or protectors of property rights, but otherwise don't think of intellectual property as being being property, or sometimes even constitutionalist, you know, on the one hand, but don't see this as part of the Constitution, and or conservatives. So we do try and appeal to those. I agree with you. I doubt if we're going to convince free press and public knowledge, really. But I'm always open to trying. As those of you who know me know, that's what we do in a think tank. We keep trying. So with that, I'm going to turn to Ralph Ohm. And again, I feel honored to have Ralph here. I've known Rob for a long time and consider Rob a good friend. Ralph will tell you that we had never met before this morning. We communicated by email, but I've admired him, and I asked him to take a look at our book when we had a draft, and he was willing to do that, which I appreciated very much. So Ralph, why don't you take it?
Thank you, Randy. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here. I must confess that I don't recognize the Congress you're describing. It's, in my opinion, still a bipartisan consensus that governs intellectual property, and no one's a stauncher champion of intellectual property and copyrights than John Conyers, the Democrat who's ranking on the Judiciary Committee. That is the interesting discussion. I wish that had been my assignment, Randy, to discuss the nature of copyright on Capitol Hill. I'm teaching a seminar on that at George Washington Law School this semester, and it is a great topic. But let me stick to my assignment. I'll be talking about the application of the broad principles that the authors so brilliantly stated in their book, applying those broad principles to the challenges that copyright faces in the age of the internet. As the authors stated, copyright started as an exclusive property right in 1790 with the passage of the first Copyright Act. But that exclusivity, that feature that was so important to the founders, has been whittled away over the past 100 years. Market failure was the rationale. A few users convinced Congress that the free market just wouldn't work. The transactions were too small. They were too numerous. The bargaining powers of the two parties were too unequal. or that the time frame needed to make to arrange a license was too short, and that we really couldn't rely on the free market to set prices and to control access. But today, digital technology has changed that reality, if in fact it ever was a reality. Microchips, little black boxes, they'll mediate millions of transactions in a millisecond. They'll screen transactions searching for copyright management information. They'll work at the speed of light. With this technology, we can restore, in my opinion, the author's exclusive control over their works that the founders built into the copyright and patent clause. They can license them. They can license them collectively as part of a group. They can make them available for free if they want. They can say no. They can say yes if the price is right. Think cable television and the history of the cable television compulsory license. Think of the digital audio tape machines back in the early 90s. Think of jukeboxes going back into the mists of history, jukeboxes being a way of life in the South, the only cultural outlet available in most southern communities, and the powerful members of Congress from the South were able to block copyright liability for jukeboxes when, by principle, they should have been paying to use the music to make money. Thinking of the digital audio tape machines, I personally was involved in that effort when I was the Register of Copyrights. The DAT, the digital audio tape machine, could make perfect copies of sound recordings without any degradation of the quality of the sound from one generation to the next. I testified before the House Intellectual Property Subcommittee in support of a bill that would implement a very, very complicated compulsory license. It sanctioned home taping for an indirect royalty. It prohibited serial copying, which was very important to the record industry. It aimed to balance the interests of all the parties, namely the creative community, the Japanese equipment manufacturers, the home tapers. The chairman, Bill Hughes of New Jersey, and Carlos Moorhead of California, both vented their anguish, their frustration over the complicated regulatory scheme of the proposed legislation. It had been negotiated on a Greek island over the holiday season by the record industry and the equipment manufacturers, and it was 57 pages long. Chairman Hughes complained, the Copyright Act is going to look like the tax code if we don't change our ways. But in fact, they did adopt that proposal. They asked me if I was troubled by the length of the bill, by the detail that I get into, even the accounting procedures to be used in determining who got what. I was a good soldier at the hearing, and I said what was expected of me, that it was a technical problem, it needed a technical solution. The bill did that. But what I should have said, and didn't say, simply, wouldn't it be better, wouldn't it be much simpler to say, okay, songwriters, okay, record companies, it's your music. You can do with it what you want. You can lock it in a vault for all we care. Just make clear that it can't be copied without your authorization. If you don't want people to make perfect copies, on their digital audio tape machines, you can say no. You can sue the manufacturer of the infringing machines, the copying machines, for contributory infringement. That's what I should have said, but didn't. The copyright owners should have been allowed to negotiate a deal with the equipment manufacturers that would have allowed this new digital technology to reach the public under rules of the marketplace, one that was acceptable to both sides. If Congress had simply reaffirmed the exclusive right that the authors talk about in their book, the free market forces would have done the rest. Another example that I won't get into detail on was television in the 50s. Motion picture industry saw television as a direct threat. They refused to license their works to the television networks. What happened? Did the television networks go out of business? No. It ushered in the golden age of television, where the networks had to produce all of their own materials, and we had a terrific assortment of choices for the viewing public. That was when the system worked right. Congress didn't rush in with a compulsory license telling the motion picture industry, you have to license your works for the television networks or else we'll impose a compulsory license on you. Authors have something to sell, users want to buy. Congress should just reaffirm the historic exclusive property right of the authors, get out of the way, and let the parties do a deal. The very best copyright laws have always protected the rights of creators and the powers of the creators against the powers of the company, the companies and others that earn money making machines that use the copyrighted works, that build business models like Google, that exploit authors' works. That would be ideal. The internet is the latest wrinkle that began with the invention of the printing press. The tension between these new technologies and the interests of authors are nothing new. They really shouldn't surprise us. It's the very essence of copyright thinking, the core that makes copyright socially revolutionary, historically unique, and worth fighting for. And I thank the authors, Mr. May and Mr. Cooper, for giving us the ammunition we need to fight that war. This book should be required reading for all members of Congress, federal judges, and all political stripes from Capitol Hill. Thank you.
Okay. Well, I want to second that. Was that a motion? I second that motion. Ralph, thank you very, very much. Now, we are going to move to questions and comments from the audience shortly, but and we're also going to ask the panelists whether they want to add or subtract anything, and I actually want to have a question for Rob, but I'm going to take the liberty of doing this since it would be one register of copyrights following another one, because Mary Beth Peters couldn't be here today, but she's a former register of copyrights as well, and I just want to quote her blurb here that's on your sheet. I love the book, and I hope it finds a large audience. Over the years, I've had many people tell me my interpretation of the Constitution's intellectual property clause was wrong. Hopefully, this new book, with its scholarly yet readable treatment, will refocus the debate about IP rights on first principles and our founders' intentions. And then just right below her blurb, Ted Olson, Solicitor General of the United States from 2001 to 2004, Ted said, quote, a fascinating, illuminating, and insightful exploration of the roots of intellectual property law in America, essential for students, teachers, and practitioners in the field, intellectually sound and highly readable. He left out Congress, Congress critters, but I'm sure he would have included them if he had thought about it. Now, I'm going to play a little game. If you have come to some of our other events, you know I'd like to do this once in a while. It's going to be a little contest. I'm going to read a quote, and if you can tell me who is the author of this quote or said this, then you will win a free book. And I'm going to give only a couple people a chance to do it. Who has the answer? You can't have the answer. No one has the answer. Not even my wife has the answer. Okay, quote, "I always thought the man that made the corn should eat the corn," close quote. Oh, God. Yes?
Is that Abraham Lincoln?
It is. Okay. Whoa. Congratulations. That's good. So you come up afterwards and get your book. So while I've got that quote open, a little less prosaically, but I think in the same vein, in 1847, Lincoln wrote, quote, "Each individual is naturally entitled to do as he pleases with himself and the fruit of his labor." And this is all part of the discussion we have about Lincoln's focus on labor, free labor, and the person's right to enjoy the fruits of his own labor. And I think there's a lot of material that's in that chapter. In fact, I know there is, that I think most of you wouldn't be familiar with. Okay, that said, Rob, I just want to ask you, and thanks again for your remarks, but I know that you also, I believe, at ITIF, which does such awfully good work, you study or have studied the contribution that IP makes to our economy. And we didn't, in this book, that was not the focus. I mean, we allude to it as well, but it's not the focus of the book. But can you just say a few words about putting aside, you know, the philosophical rationale, but the importance of intellectual property to the economy at this point in time?
Yeah, I mean, there's a few things that we've...
You want to use that? Yeah.
A few things we've written, mostly look at what other people's work have done. I think there's two ways to answer that. One is to look at how the U.S. economy has evolved into a much more knowledge and intangible capital-based economy than we were 15 or 20 years ago, and that is much of that new production is IP-based, and so that's why I think losing this fight against IP in the U.S. Means that we're going to have a higher risk of losing it globally, which has very important implications for our economy, and much more than almost any economy in the world. But the second answer is there was a study by Rob Shapiro. And Rob looked at this a couple of years ago, and I think I'm going to get the number wrong. I don't know if anybody knows Rob's study, but he found something on the order of 45% of U.S. GDP was IP-based, IP-dependent. It's in that ballpark. I don't remember the exact number.
$1.1 trillion, according to Mr. Tepp, who's just published a white paper.
Well, that would be a lot less than 45%.
That was the CyWEC study.
That may have been copyright.
Copyright.
Yes.
Specifically copyright.
Copyright's about 8, 10, 12%. This was IP dependent, so it would include patent industries and others.
I was probably drifting, but I think the number, I mean, I saw a number recently that for both segments, and if you express it in terms of IP dependent, it was on the realm of 30 or 35%. Is that what you, did you say?
I said low 40s. But
yeah. So anyway, it's a big number that, you know, aside from whatever your philosophical disposition may be in terms of the economic health of the country, it's important to protect these rights. Well, I'm going to ask our panelists, Seth, do you or Ralph or Rob want to say anything, add anything that's sort of on top of what we've said thus far at this point? Anything? Okay, let's see whether we have some questions or comments. Steve, you can tell us what that acronym was that you just used for the...
CyWEC?
Yeah.
CyWEC is not an acronym, it's the man's last name.
Oh, okay.
My name is Steve Tepp.
You see, we didn't get into that in the, in our study. Stephen just did a good thing. When you speak, if you can introduce yourself and give us your name, that's helpful. And just so you'll know, we're transcribing this session and video recording it. So don't say anything you don't want placed on videotape.
Fair enough.
With that,
thank
go
you.
Ahead.
So, well, just to round out the question that I got pulled into a moment ago, Stephen Siwek did a study. I believe that's the source for the $1.1 trillion contribution to the economy from copyright and copyright-related industries. The broader number, Robert, that I think you're talking to comes from the U.S. Department of Commerce Patent and Trademark Office, a study that they did, which concluded that the entire set of IP industries provide over $5 trillion to the U.S. economy, over two-thirds of U.S. exports. So yes, quite significant parts of our economy. But what I really wanted to ask about was this. Personally, I've spent some time looking into the issue of intellectual property rights as property rights, and I think that the historic evidence and the legal precedent is overwhelming, that clearly patent and copyright are exclusive property rights in our constitutional system. Your book takes the additional step of attributing to that they are natural rights. And so, playing devil's advocate a little bit, I'm going to challenge you with the question, why did the founders, if patent and copyright are natural rights, provide in the Constitution the requirement that the term of protection be limited in contrast to real and personal property rights?
Yeah, well, that's a good question, which I appreciate. And, you know, I think the answer is that natural rights, I don't think that we maintain in the book that their focus was on natural rights to the exclusion of any other arguments that you could suggest. I mean, we've got a material in the book that actually deals with you know, Jefferson's supposed antipathy towards monopolies, which is, I know you're talking about the terms of, you know, opposed to, you know, monopolies and how that's reconcilable with property rights. And we deal with that. But I think, you know, they didn't view that there weren't other dispositions, if I could say, that would come into play, but that the natural rights philosophy, which they got again from Locke, and you know, there's a lot of evidence about the looking to the classical liberal, you know, philosophy in terms of protecting property rights, that was important, and I think the limited terms was a concession to that, and you know, it is one of those boundary issues that I mentioned at the beginning, where you then might rely on other types of theories, like a utilitarian theory for how long that should be. Anyone want to add anything, Seth?
Yeah, I think that I think there was a recognition first of just structurally, property rights are primarily subjects that are left to the states in the Constitution. So the IP clause is one of the only areas where you have a set of property rights that are specifically within the province of the federal government to define and to enforce. It does so indirectly in other respects, but here it's really central. And any kind of property right is going to have some kind of limits, some kind of boundaries, some kind of adjustments need to be made for everyone to enjoy them or to enjoy them consistent with all their other rights. So I think it makes more sense to put some of those limitations in the IP clause simply because that responsibility is being given to Congress in the first place. And I also think that I think there's a recognition as well that because you're dealing with intangibles and someone's productions from their mind, at some point in time it may become too difficult to administer them when you're so far removed in years and circumstances. That it may cause more harm than good, and you can still protect the core of that right consistent with everybody else by setting some kind of term that's ascertainable, that's understandable, that's adopted in accordance with law. And, you know, I think Daniel Webster said in one of his cases, you know, he affirmed that, I think it was the India rubber case that I quoted earlier, where he asserts the Natural Rights Foundation, and he says, and actually it was in Wheaton versus Peters, Daniel Webster said, look, it's a right that it may require special or extraordinary legislation to protect it, including legislation to limit it, be it so. That's just the way it is.
Okay, we have some questions, but before I forget, I just, as a housekeeping matter, I want to thank, like you to join me in thanking some people here. Kathy Baker is our events coordinator, and she's standing there, and I want to thank her. Mike Horney, research associate at the Free State Foundation, and my wife always plays an important role in almost everything I do, so we should thank her. And then finally, I'm pleased that my wife is choking on that, but she's choking on that, but it is true that she plays an important role in most things that I do. I alter that. And finally, John Farley is in the back. He's a senior official with the Fund for American Studies, and John is a member of the Free State Foundation's board of directors, and has always been an important source of support for the foundation, and we appreciate that. So would you thank those guys? And Laurie, I'm sorry if you choked on that. Okay, who has a question next? Okay, right over here, Kathy, and just identify yourself, please.
Thank you very much. John Graham from the National Center for Policy Analysis, and I'm really looking forward to reading the book. And I'm also, just by good chance, I have my handy-dandy Constitution, courtesy of the Cato. And I noticed the IP clause is separated by six different enumerated powers from the international, from the Commerce Clause, right? And yet so much of what we do in IP these days has to do with international issues. So I wonder if any of what the founders did, you know, from Madison, Jefferson through Lincoln, is there anything there that helps us, guides us on the international context of IP?
I'm not sure at that time how much they were guided back at the time of the founding. I'm not recalling something, but Seth, I know it's obviously important these days, the international aspect, and we have international treaties and so forth. But at the time of the founding, were they influenced by international?
You know, I don't, at that point, they were definitely focused on building up American industry. And so you have, we don't go into this in the book, although Randy and I will be writing about this in the future. Alexander Hamilton, his report on manufacturers, he did talk about the importance of growing the industry at home to make America a self-sufficient nation in terms of manufacturing and also in terms of writing. But you do find in this era, particularly with the state legislation, you kind of find a principle that's familiar in international contexts that becomes helpful, is some of the early state legislation on copyrights would say, like Massachusetts, we will recognize foreign states, meaning other independent sovereign states, we'll recognize their copyrights as soon as they recognize ours. And so by the 1830s, you get in the Patent Act, you do get that recognized in the patent context. It was a much longer fight to get that in the copyright context, that recognized, and it was caught up with issues having to do with trade publishers at home found it cheaper to reprint Charles Dickens, for instance, than to pay Washington Irving royalties. So, you know, you can just get the newest copy off the ship and run off your own thing. They did finally get it, and so they were able to sort of see that principle of just, hey, we'll recognize Britain's if they recognize ours. Well, United States was a little late to the game, but you can kind of see that in the early state legislation. It provided that model.
I see Ralph has a comment.
An interesting angle to that that evolution toward international protection for copyright. The pressure for protecting British works, French works, German works, didn't come from the British, the French, and the Germans. It came from American authors who couldn't compete. The publishers, sure, it's cheaper to publish without having to pay a royalty to the author, so that's what they did. supposedly in whatever it was, 1856, people were clinging to the docks in New York, waiting for the ship to come in with the latest version of one of Dickens' novels, all shouting, "Did little Nell die? Did little Nell die?" The tremendous popularity of British works convinced Congress that they should move in the international direction, and they did pass the legislation in 1891, and that set us on the road to adherence to the Berne Convention, which is not based on reciprocity. I'll protect you if you protect me, but on national treatment, which was a big step forward for the United States.
Okay, Tim.
Real quick,
wait. Get. Let me see. I don't know where the mic went. Oh.
Tim Lee, Center for Individual Freedom. Just in response to what Steve said, one thing I'd like to point out is that other things that we accept as natural rights, First Amendment rights, you know, we obviously have no right to defamation. Real property, you know, the bane of every first-year law student's existence is the rule against perpetuities. So, you know, one answer to the question of, well, why isn't this unlimited in time like most other natural rights in the Constitution is that most of those rights aren't unlimited in time either, whether it's real property with the rule against perpetuity. Second Amendment obviously has limitations on it, so you know that might be one way as well.
Yeah, no, that's useful, although I guess Steve might say in response, it's in the IP clause itself, it refers to the limitations, whereas the First Amendment, all these restrictions, which you rightly point out are on almost every other right we can think of, aren't necessarily expressed in the same way. So next we're going to turn to Tom here. Just a minute, Tom.
Hi, Randy. Tom Sidner, American Enterprise Institute, Center for Internet Communications Technology Policy. I hope, because great minds think alike, we've actually been working on some pretty similar issues. I came out with a paper last week dealing with some of the, because I'd really like to, it's time to put an end to some of the copyrights or monopolies arguments, and I think we're at a point where we can't. So I've been looking at some of the same issues, including Mr. Connell's arguments about how the founders looked at copyright. And I had two questions. Number one, I thought Seth made an extremely important point about the early, in talking about international issues, about, you know, so the international dimension of copyright protection. I think you made an extremely important point about the fact that the original state, that before we get to the Federal Copyright Act 1790, back in 1783, the original state copyright laws contained reciprocity provisions, which, you know, become irrelevant once we get the Federal Copyright Act in 1790. We're essentially our own little copyright union, and we're geographically isolated. So if you look at the evolution of international, of truly international rather than interstate, copyright protection in Europe in the 19th century, it actually starts with reciprocity and then, as Ralph said, moves on to national treatment, which is much better. So I think that's an important point. We just kind of got lucky. We were on a little union for a while. But I did want to ask you one thing about the subtitle of your book. Having been working on these same issues, I noted in one of my end notes that I am explicitly not relying for the proposition that copyrights should not be treated as monopolies on natural law theory. And I'm not doing that because I disagree with you in any way, manner, shape, or form that copyrights or intellectual property rights generally fall within the national law or natural law tradition. I think
Wait a minute. I want to make sure you may have used a double negative. You're not disagreeing. You're not
I
doing
agree
it.
Entirely with you.
You agree entirely.
As in many issues, Randy, I have been vigorously agreeing with you on for years. And this is no exception. But I do wonder, does it really matter whether you ground copyrights in the in intellectual property rights in the natural law tradition? Because it seems to me that even if you argue that they're socially constructed, that, you know, property rights are socially constructed and we enforce them because they're useful over the long run, you still get to the same conclusion that you need effective protection, particularly if you want to encourage commercial investment, because investors could invest in something else. And if you narrow their property rights too much, then aren't we discouraging them from investing in the production of expression rather than its dissemination? So what, other than some, I think Rob's point about the rhetorical advantages of the natural law tradition are valid, do we really, can you reach the same, do you think you can reach the same conclusions even if you think that property rights are socially constructed?
I think you could, depending on, you know, how you then view the social construction. But for a lot of people, I would say you could, and maybe yourself. And so I don't want to, if you end up in the same place, I don't want to discourage you, because I think their intellectual property rights are important to protect, so whatever works. But if you're asking about us, why we did it, I think it was an enterprise, in terms of scholarship, in which we wanted to. I mean, I guess it's fair to say, and I mentioned that Seth attended that Claremont Institute fellowship, and the Claremont Institute is known to have this natural rights disposition. So. And I think we were disposed in that way. I mean, I'm one, for example, that looks to, aside from where you come out on arguments, for example, as to whether the Declaration of Independence has any standing as a matter of law, as positive law, and I understand all the debates, and aside from where you come out there, for example, the Declaration of Independence, particularly the preamble, which if you look at it, has whoever's got that little book, it's a very, natural rights statement, the nature's God and God's, whatever the phrase is, it's a statement of natural rights. For me, it's an important philosophical way, of understanding why the founders did what they did and why they placed enough importance on the intellectual property clause to place it in the Constitution, as opposed to using the Commerce Clause, I guess you could say, to adopt the first Patent Act or Copyright Act. It's a statement of what they thought and what the founders thought, to me, again, without having a debate now about originalism versus some other theory, but what the founders thought is important, I think. And so that's the way I would answer the question. And for some people it may, there may be people that it have some reason, I wouldn't fully understand it, but have some reason where they react against, natural rights. Well, that's old. Who gives a damn what John Locke thought and founders? But, that's not the way we look at things at the Free State Foundation. My good friend, Alden Abbott.
Thank you, Randy. Excellent presentation. I think just to strengthen Randy's argument, good argument, is that the reason it matters is that there's been a cottage industry of academics, I think wrongly, but have been attacking on instrumentalist pragmatic grounds their view that patent rights not only don't encourage innovation, but impose net costs on the economy. Ever since Justice Breyer and other academics, he wrote a famous article, The Uneasy Case for Copyright, there have been instrumentalist attacks on copyright saying they don't really promote innovation, you don't need it. So you need a bulwark. I mean, I think there are answers to those attacks, but it's all too easy to say, oh, the experts have spoken, these rights don't matter, if, however, their first principles, constitutionally based principles, that back those rights, that is very powerful ammunition and a bulwark in light of all of these recent instrumentalist attacks.
Hey, we've got time for maybe a couple more questions, and then we'll probably call it. But if I don't say it later, I'll say it now. I'm I'm really pleased and gratified for how many people showed up. I think it's a tribute to Seth here, I should say. It's a great turnout, again, for the first intellectual property event we've done at the Press Club. Patrick, did you have your hand up? Patrick?
Thank you, Kathy. Thanks, Randy. And Seth, congratulations. Really terrific. Look forward to reading the book, but just the teasers that I've seen look very fascinating. Sorry to belabor the point, but I think it's an interesting question that has been raised, and you know, the responses have dwelled on the copyright side, where I think there's a more natural sort of foundation in natural rights. What about the patent side of things? And I always sort of think back to you know, the invention of the wheel, and the guy in the cave next door. If he didn't imitate that, it would be nuts, right? And nobody would blame him for it. So how do we reconcile intellectual property rights universally with some of these ideas?
Well, I mean, the patent rights, you know, which go obviously to inventions. I mean, I think that quote I read from Noah Webster, where he talked about, you know, works with created with your own hand, and I think you said muscular strength or whatever. I mean, that goes to the inventions as opposed to the literary property. So, I mean, I think both fit comfortably within the labor theory, or the fruits of your labor theory, whether it's writings or discoveries and inventions that I talked about. You know, again, in both cases, and this goes back to another point, you always have the boundary issues, and you can make, you know, there are a lot of questions about how long patent protection should be and whatever, but each of these two sides of intellectual property that we've discussed, copyright and patent, I mean, in terms of the law and the way it's developed and applied, there are limitations, restraints that are within the law that then serve to advance the interest of others who want to create and produce in society. I mean, again, on we expound on it more in the book, but in the copyright side, you've got the idea expression dichotomy, right? So you can't copyright ideas, but just the expression of ideas, and that's a limitation, so that others can use it. On the patent side, and I know less about the details of, you know, modern patent law, but that's not what our book is about. But there's novelty, you know, there's a requirement that an invention be novel, right? Or I know it gets esoteric as to everything that's involved, but that is a way of restraining the inventor's original claim in a certain way, so that I think these things are reconciled in ways like that. Okay, do we have, I said two, if we have one more question. Okay, the winner of the book. Now, you've got to tell me, though, how you knew that quote from Abraham Lincoln before you asked your question.
I actually stumbled across that on someone's blog that I reposted. So thank you for asking that question. I was lucky.
Okay. When I stumbled across that quote in some context a few years ago, I just thought it was neat about the seed corn, and I used it in a blog that I wrote, a Labor Day blog.
That sounds about the right time.
Praising Labor Day. Okay.
So Google has recently had a plan to digitalize every single book ever written. And as authors yourselves, I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that plan, if that's good or bad for authors and IP.
Well, I don't think it's good if they do it without protecting my copyright and right. I mean, there are ways to do this. I know, I don't think that's Google's position anymore. There are a lot of questions about the orphan works and the older works and how they could possibly, contact people and whether the rights have expired. But I don't is it? It's not their plan to do it without the permission of the copyright holder, is it? In this case, is it? Well, I don't know. Is it?
No permission.
Yeah.
So I've just been upheld.
Yeah. Oh. Oh, see, yeah, no, I know. They. I thought that ruling, it just was about a week.
They digitized the whole thing, but
yeah.
In general, the public would just get to see snippets.
Oh, I thought you meant put it up. But you're right, that was just a ruling in the last week or two, right? And you know, I'm sure there'll be questions about whether the snippets are, you know, consistent with fair use, or there may be, but I'm sorry. I thought you were just asking, could they just put the whole book up? I mean, they're pretty aggressive, if I might say, sometimes in the positions that they take with regard to intellectual property, but I don't think that was their proposal.
Randy, I think the key question is, if your book is really any good, how many days, when was what was the publishing date?
September 9th of this year.
Okay, so you should be on the Pirate Bay by now, I hope. And if you're not, it tells you something about your book, I think.
Yeah. Well, thanks for putting it that way, Rob. Didn't you say you had another event, another event to go to? Okay, well, you've been a remarkably attentive audience, and also the questions were terrific, so I appreciate that. So I'm just going to ask you just to thank all of our participants, and we're adjourned.